my first meal is at 2 p.m. and then I eat from 2 to 10.
A trendy new weight loss method has been getting a lot of buzz lately, and it is called intermittent fasting.
When our body needs fuel, it can break down unnecessary components of tissues and cells to use it as energy.
There was recently a Nobel Prize in Medicine awarded for work on autophagy. This shows great promise in reversing cancer, Alzheimer's, and it has also shown promise for anti-aging.
What do fitness YouTubers, starving fungi, and toxic aggregates in the brain have in common? No, this is not the beginning of a bad joke. They all have been revolutionized by one person who was working alone in a tiny room in Japan when he discovered how our cells eat themselves. My name is Gimmons, and today we'll talk about autophagy, what happens if our brain eat our cells, and how we might live longer. It's the year 1988, Tokyo, Japan. A scientist called Yoshinori Ohsumi unpacks his boxes. He just moved back to Japan to start his research. For now though, he will work alone on a research topic no one really has been interested in for over two decades. Come on, Yoshinori, study something cool. All cool kids study cancer nowadays. Yeah, or how about neuroscience? The brain is interesting, right? But he had something else in mind. It had been known for quite a while that when cells are stressed, they destroy parts of themselves. This process was named autophagy. Autophagy is derived from the Greek word autophagos, or self-devouring. Autophagy has been described, but most people thought that it wasn't that important. Ohsumi, however, felt that this phenomenon was special and could revolutionize our understanding of biology. He theorized that autophagy is something highly important for the cell. You see, autophagy can help the cell to renew itself and gain valuable nutrients to live longer. So he started with a simple experiment. He cultivated genetically modified yeast cells in a laboratory. Then he starved the cells to see how the organism responds. When he looked under the microscope, he saw that cells started to eat parts of themselves. Then he continued and destroyed all kinds of genes to see which are involved in this process. In this manner, he fully characterized how autophagy worked. What seemed like a simple discovery could change biology and medicine forever. It just needed some time. Over the years, Ohsumi started to dissect how autophagy works. And although it took a while, scientists slowly started to work on the topic as well. As it turns out, autophagy doesn't only happen in yeast, but also in mammals and in us humans. In fact, autophagy was discovered in all different parts of the human body, in the brain, the pancreas, and the muscles. Then, the shock. Autophagy is not only important for our cells, but disrupting it is detrimental and can cause disease. Scientists started to identify more and more diseases which are at least partially explained by issues in autophagy. This included immune disorders, cancer, or brain disorders. When Ohsumi started to describe autophagy, there were only 20 publications a year in this field. Today there are over 5,000 works per year. For his work, Ohsumi received the Nobel Prize in Physiology or Medicine in 2016. So yeah guys, if you really want to do something,
just do it!
But as it turns out, this was only the start. Scientists now start to understand how controlling autophagy can possibly make us live healthier and longer. A short disclaimer, this is the fifth time we already talk about aging on this channel. Today we only focus on aging and autophagy. But of course there are also many other important factors of aging which are covered in the other videos, so you might want to check them out later. After autophagy was described, scientists started to understand what happens when it goes wrong. First description of diseases where autophagy seems to be dysfunctional date back over 100 years. In 1901, a doctor was walking through the dark halls of a mental institution where he interviewed several patients. The day seemed quite ordinary, but then he met one patient. This patient, a 51-year-old woman, captivated him. The woman seemed to be confused and she couldn't remember her name. Upon further investigation, the doctor found out that this patient behaved completely normal throughout her life. Only in the past years, she seemed to forget things more often and became paranoid. The doctor just couldn't forget her, and after she died, he decided to dissect her brain. And what he found was unusual. Her cells contained accumulations of proteins. He theorized that these accumulations might have made her sick. And so he published his findings. The doctor's name was Alzheimer, and this is how he first described Alzheimer's disease. Over the years, other scientists discovered weird accumulations in cells in completely different diseases. In 1912, Frederick Louis dissected the brains of Parkinson's disease patients and found abnormal accumulations in the brain. Other scientists found protein aggregations in patients who suffer from frontotemporal dementia. And occasionally, protein aggregations can even be found in heart disease. It seems like that accumulations in a brain are somehow all involved in all kinds of different diseases. And then finally, scientists could connect all the dots when they started to understand how aging works. Our cells have to stick with us throughout our lives and constantly perform the tasks. This can be highly stressful and damage parts of the cells. Autophagy is important for our cells. It enables them to recycle all damaged parts to build new structures and renew themselves. There are different forms of autophagy in the body, but in general, autophagy is indispensable for regions where cells have to survive for long periods of time. This includes brain cells, which have to stay functional for years and years. As we get older though, autophagy becomes less effective. It might not seem dramatic in the beginning, but cells slowly accumulate damages. As a result, cells might become dysfunctional and bloated. And together with other factors, this then leads to the death of the cell. If that only happens to a couple of cells, it might not be too dramatic. However, if enough cells are being damaged and destroyed, then we might have a disease. In the case of many brain diseases, complex processes lead to slow accumulations of proteins in the brain. Autophagy, which normally destroys its accumulations, is defect, and the accumulations can spread, first in one brain region, and then in a different brain region. This doesn't happen overnight, but instead it takes decades until we have a full-fledged disease. Suddenly our brain becomes compromised, and we develop all the symptoms we observe in these diseases. But of course, brain diseases are very complicated, and autophagy is only one aspect. So there are many genetic and environmental factors which play roles. But scientists find more and more evidence that a failure in removing protein accumulations is one key factor. But what if we find a way to control autophagy? Could we potentially live healthier and longer? Right now, roughly 1 billion people worldwide are aged 60 or older. In 2050 though, this number will double to 2.1 million. In the same time span, the number of people who suffer from dementia will increase from 57 million people today to over 150 million in 2050. And this is why some scientists try to slow down aging and make us potentially live longer and healthier. Drugs which target the aging process have often been developed for other purposes. Rapamycin is an FDA-approved drug which is used to treat liver transplant rejection or cancer. In the past 30 years though, it was found that rapamycin significantly prolongs the lives of various animals, including worms, flies, and mice. It was further shown that rapamycin delays the onset of age-related diseases in animals. Several studies found that mice which suffered from Alzheimer's disease and were treated with rapamycin had increased autophagy activity, less protein accumulations in the brain, and better memory. In humans, rapamycin has not been used to treat Alzheimer's disease yet. However, it has been used in some short-term clinical studies. In one study, patients aged over 40 applied two different skin creams on the left and right hand. One skin cream contained rapamycin, while the other did not. They applied the creams for 8 months, and it was found that the skin of patients became overall more youthful if they were treated with rapamycin. This means that skin cells were more active, skin structures showed more integrity, and the hands appeared younger in photographs. Now, there are some people who try to do clinical studies on Alzheimer's disease and rapamycin treatment, but there has been no data released yet. The next drug is metformin. Metformin is a drug that has been developed to treat type 2 diabetes. But as it turns out, metformin also prolongs the lives of different animals and has been shown to induce autophagy. And also here, there has been no clinical study completed yet which has shown that metformin can slow down aging in humans, but there are some being planned. Right now there's a big trial which enrolls over 3,000 people. But again, it hasn't been finished yet, so I keep you updated. And then there's spermidin. Spermidin is a natural compound that has been shown to increase the lifespan of different animals by inducing autophagy. And what is important is that spermidin is also produced in us. It has been shown that spermidin levels generally decline with increased age, but people who survive the age of 90 have overall high levels of natural occurring spermidin. Spermidin-rich foods also has been shown to decrease the risk of heart disease and cancer. But especially here, these are only observational studies, so we need really to confirm them. But as always, we do not have to wait for scientists to come up with some magical drugs. We can do something to live healthy and potentially longer, even when it comes to autophagy. Here is what you can do to trigger autophagy in your body. Number 1. Intermittent fasting. Intermittent fasting means that we only eat at certain times a day. Variations of intermittent fasting include 16 hours of fasting per day, fasting one day a week, or eating less food 2 days a week. As it turns out, intermittent fasting is a great way to induce autophagy. When we undergo fasting, our cells experience a mild form of stress. As a consequence, they kick off responses, which promote autophagy. And in this manner, they can recycle old components and get nutrients. Intermittent fasting has been shown to benefit our bodies in multiple ways, but it's specifically interesting what happens to our brains. Intermittent fasting reduces inflammation in the brain and helps to preserve brain regions important for memory. Intermittent fasting has also been shown to promote the formation of new connections between brain cells and increase the number of brain cells in the hippocampus. So overall, intermittent fasting seems to be extremely healthy for our bodies. And besides intermittent fasting, we can also do something else. Number 2, exercise. Yeah, as mentioned so often on his channel. Studies suggest that regular exercises help to trigger autophagy. In one study, it was found that aged mice who are physically active exhibit fewer protein aggregations in the brain and a higher degree of autophagy. Swimming has also been shown to improve learning and memory by modulating autophagy. In humans, regular aerobic exercise has been shown to reduce the risk in developing Alzheimer's disease by increasing the blood flow to the brain and reducing the accumulations of protein aggregations. At the same time, regular exercising is also associated with higher cognition and learning ability. So yeah, we can really do a lot to live healthier and possibly longer. Today, many fitness YouTubers talk about autophagy, but what nearly no one really knows is that all of this started with one scientist, who followed his passion and grew one of the most influential topics in cell biology. We understand how autophagy works, but we are just beginning to grasp how we can use it for our advantage. Can we develop drugs to regulate and remove toxic aggregations and live longer? The next years will tell. With that, a question to you. What should I cover next? I hope that you enjoyed this video, and if so, feel free to like it and comment and subscribe if you're new here and do all the other great YouTube stuff. And with that, I'll see ya. If you're interested in how to get smarter or how we might slow down aging, you might like these videos.